a remote corner of southwestern France. Perched high on its hilltop, an isolated village, tiny. Rennes-le-Château, a village forbidden to the archaeologist, fouille interdite, excavation forbidden. Why? What could there be hidden in so insignificant a place that would be worth digging for? And what has he to do with it? What secret does this parchment conceal? What connects this gravestone with this painting by Poussin? And what link is there between St. Dagobert, the Emperor Titus, and this French priest? What great treasure did he find here 80 years ago? Rennes-le-Château. There is little to suggest to the casual visitor the drama of its hidden story. A little church, a crumbling chateau, a few houses, and 60 inhabitants. To this dot on the map, in the late 1880s, was sent a young priest, Béranger Saunière, a virile, handsome, ambitious man, to whom this village must have seemed a place of exile, a dead end. His first years here were a time of poverty and hardship. His accounts show over 16 months, expenses 90 francs, £3.60, income only 25 francs. Unable to afford even a modest lodging, his home was a crumbling shack, even more dilapidated than his little church. The state of the church fabric caused Saunière much concern. This building, which should have been the centerpiece of his life and of the lives of his flock, was growing daily more ruinous. In desperation, Saunière begged a small sum from the mayor to carry out the most urgent repairs. With no idea how the debt would ever be repaid, he set to work. The altar stone was damaged. He had it lifted from its supporting pillars. One of the pillars, this one, was hollow. Inside, parchments, passages from the Gospels in Latin. The first link in a chain of discovery which led to wealth and luxury for this poor parish priest, and endless speculation and investigation for those who have since then stumbled onto the mystery. They're curious documents, the one oddly arranged on the page, the other dotted with scores of interpolated letters. Saunière soon realized that they contained ciphers. He needed the advice of experts. Borrowing the cost of the fare, he traveled to Paris and went immediately to see the director of the seminary of the Church of Saint-Sulpice, whose nephew he knew had the necessary skill. During the week or so that it took the paleographer to study the documents, Saunière made the most of his unexpected holiday. In some extraordinary way, he was able to make the acquaintance of the glamorous and world-famous opera singer, Emma Calvé. His cloth was evidently no bar to a ripening friendship, which was to continue spasmodically over the years to come. However, his liaison with Calvé was not the only curiosity to stem from this trip to Paris. At last, at Saint-Sulpice, the expert was ready with his findings. And all unknowing, he put into the priest's hand the key to an incredible fortune. Saunière now undertook a strange errand. He paid a visit to the Louvre. And there he chose to buy a copy of this painting by Nicolas Poussin. He then returned immediately to Rennes-le-Château and to a totally new life. Within a short space of time, he was spending money at an extraordinary rate. He bought land. He laid out this garden. On one side, he built a handsome house, the Villa Bethany. On the other side, this dramatic tower, the Tour Magdala. No expense was spared. No expense seemed too much. Why did Sunil's expert not realize the value of the secret the priest had found in his little church? The answer would seem to be quite simple. In Sunil's country, the streams, the very rocks, bear strange names. And what significance would a stranger find in a reference to the circle, the dead man, or the eagle's nest? But Sunil knew. And from his tower, he could keep watch over the countryside, which, no longer a dead end, was now so precious to him. His newfound wealth depended on a secret, and Sonier took pains to protect it. Some of the gravestones in his churchyard were evidently connected with the mystery. He obliterated the inscriptions, moved stones. Under this arch is one of them, featureless now. But by a lucky chance, the wording had already been copied by a collector of tomb inscriptions. This is what Sonier took such pains to wipe out. This stone lay on the grave of Marie de Négry d'Ablès, Countess of Blanchefort. And this is the headstone of that same grave. It's a curious inscription, prepared in 1781 by the Blanchefort family chaplain, Antoine Bigou, the reputed author of Sonier's parchments. And like one of the parchments, it's curiously arranged. For example, the initial M of Marie has been separated. Requiescat has been split in two. This stone held part of the secret, and Sonier made sure that the stone should no longer speak. In many ways, his behavior became odd. He spent days wandering the hillsides, collecting stones, he said, when anyone asked. And indeed, he did bring back stones, with which he built a grotto. This is all that remains of it today. What was he up to? In part, the answer lies in the church, which was totally restored and redecorated at Sonier's own expense. A labor of love, perhaps. After all, it was here that he'd found his precious parchments. The bizarre significance of all this will be examined later. Naturally, his superiors demanded an explanation of his sudden wealth, but they met with a cool response. Secrets of the confessional, gifts from wealthy people, who, I may not say. Sonier's lips were sealed, and remained so. And for the rest of his life, 25 years, he lived luxuriously, the possessor of a seemingly bottomless purse. What treasure could he possibly have found in this remote and isolated spot? The pillar gives us the first hint. Sonier has carved on it the date of his discovery, 1891, but it dates, in fact, from the dark years of the Visigoths, one of the Germanic tribes who in the 5th and 6th centuries swept across Western Europe. This tiny village is all that remains of a mighty city. Spread there below us in the valley was once Aireda, fortified citadel, powerful, boasting 30,000 inhabitants. Aireda, one of the great strongholds of the Visigothic kingdom. But before the Visigoths, the Romans were here, mining the hillsides for gold. The Visigoths and the Romans had crossed paths elsewhere than here. That crossing of paths provides one of the most dramatic clues to our mystery. In 410 AD, the Visigoths sacked Rome. The historian Procopius describes their booty, and one part in particular.
The treasures of Solomon, the king of the Hebrews, a sight most worthy to be seen. For they were adorned in the most part with emeralds, and in the olden time they had been taken from Jerusalem by the Romans.
By the Emperor Titus, in fact, in 70 AD. carried home in triumph and depicted here on Titus's arch in Rome. And so the treasure of Solomon's temple was carried off by the Visigoths. In the 5th century, their kingdom straddled the Pyrenees. Their accumulated booty was well guarded. That part which was used to finance the running of the state was held at Toulouse, and in 507 AD was captured by Clovis, king of the Franks. But it was here at Carcassonne that the other part of their treasure was held. But it was here at Carcassonne that the other part of their treasure was held. The ancient treasure, the holy treasure, guarded as a symbol of the power, continuity, and fate of the state. The treasure of which Procopius tells us Solomon's formed part. And now, at Carcassonne, we are a mere 20 miles from Ireda, which is Rennes-le-Château, Saunier's village. After the capture of Toulouse, Clovis came on to besiege Carcassonne.
For he well knew that the royal treasure was there. That treasure which aforetimes Alaric the Elder had taken as booty when Rome fell to his hand.
But the Visigoths were more tenacious here. The holy treasure had to be protected. Clovis failed in his attempt. Part of this ancient treasure was eventually taken from Carcassonne to the Spanish capital of the Visigoths, Toledo. This is some of that treasure. Hidden for security when the Arabs attacked Toledo in 711, this precious hoard was discovered in the 19th century at Guarazar. But no account of booty taken by Arabs or Franks mentions Solomon's treasure. Where did it go from Carcassonne? Under the assaults of Arab and Frank, the Visigothic kingdom was eventually reduced to the Razés, of which Ireda was a principal city, one of the few strongholds of their fading power. Could it also have been the repository of their wealth, the final resting place of the holy treasure? The next link in our chain is a curious legend concerning Ireda. The year 679, when Dagobert II, Saint Dagobert, king of the Merovingian dynasty, was assassinated. Some authorities would have his infant son murdered with him, but the legend would have us believe that this child, Sigebert, was carried to Ireda and took the title Count of Razès. Here he founded a family. And it was in the little church of Rennes-le-Château that he was eventually buried before the altar. And so what seems today to be a sleepy hamlet lost to the world does indeed have a colourful and dramatic history. Perhaps there could, after all, be something hidden away here over the centuries. Something which Saunier's lucky find could lead him to. And here is a tangible link with this past of history and legend. It was this stone that Saunier uncovered when, on his return from Paris, he chose to dig at a particular spot before the altar of his church. Much worn and damaged, this could be a mounted knight riding off with a child on his saddle bow. It could depict the rescue of St. Dagobert's infant son, Sigebert. Under the stone were also discovered two skeletons. Here is one of the skulls. The ritual incision after death is not uncommon in Merovingian burials. And here, in this reliquary, is a holy relic said to be the skull of St. Dagobert. On a hillside near the village was a standing stone, the top of which was shaped into a human head. This head, now removed from its pillar, is known as the head of Dagobert, and this too has the same mark. Had Saunier's mysterious parchments thrown some light on the legend of Dagobert? An examination of them immediately raises several points. In this one, the text is clear, but it's rather oddly arranged on the page. In this one, there are the interpolated letters. Jesus, ergo, interpolated V, ante, interpolated C, dies, interpolated P, etc. But even more apparent than these is this odd device. The general impression of the document is one of neatness. The apparent untidiness here cannot be fortuitous. Superficially, we could be looking at a direction indicator. N denotes north, indicated by the untidy arrow. But the N-O-I-S seems meaningless. At the other end of the device, we have a more clear arrowhead. But isn't this arrowhead, in fact, an A upside down? And now the N-O-I-S is perhaps no longer meaningless. Zion, Zion, Jerusalem. And we've already followed to Rennes-le-Château the possible trail of the holy treasure of the Visigoths, which may have contained relics of the sacking of Jerusalem. Now the other parchment. Why are the words at the ends of lines broken in seemingly arbitrary fashion? But here again is our key word, Zion, Jerusalem. What else? One other immediately noticeable feature is this isolated A, the only letter isolated in the text. The letter A, remember, was significant in the other parchment. And a closer examination reveals that this A is raised above the line of the other letters. Are there more raised letters? What message is being spelt out? À Dagobert de Rouen et à Zion et ce trésor et il est la mort. This treasure belongs to Dagobert II, king, and to Zion, and the last phrase is open to two different readings. Il est la mort, it is death, or il est là, mort, he is there, dead. Who, Dagobert? Were the two bodies found before the altar, those of St. Dagobert and his son Sigebert? There is, of course, more to these parchments than just this simple, one might almost say childish code. But being easy to find, the code, in effect, says to us, you're on the right lines, now look further. Saunier evidently did, and found his crock of gold. Whatever it was that he found, he was certainly jealous of the secret, but by no means selfish in his distribution of the benefits. He entertained lavishly. He made many charitable gifts. Local families received open-handed help. He built this water tower to give his parishioners piped water to their homes. He had the rough 4-kilometer-long dirt track made over into a good modern road. And he gave away not only money. To a fellow priest, he presented an ancient and beautiful chalice. To another, a collection of ancient coins like these, some of them dating from the time of Dagobert. And, of course, there was his lavish expenditure on the little village church. But this was not a simple act of generosity. It was Saunier's contribution to the pattern of mystery surrounding his treasure. Externally, there seems to be nothing exceptional here. But overhead, as we approach the door, terribilis est locus iste. This place is terrible. Terrible indeed, for once through the door. Not just a devil, but Asmodeus. And Asmodeus was the legendary guardian of Solomon's treasure. All around us is a strange phantasmagoric world of imagery and color. The more one looks, the stranger it becomes. Like his predecessors, with their cryptic parchments and tomb inscriptions, Saunier felt compelled to pass on his secret in some way. But in typically flamboyant fashion, Saunier's cipher was on a grand scale. His clue to the treasure was to be the church itself. Certainly, Saunier's bishop was disturbed when he came to bless the restored edifice. Thereafter, it seems, he paid the church no further pastoral visits. But what is Saunier saying to us in this mass of imagery? A few of the features will give an insight into his methods. For example, here Christ succors the afflicted. He stands on a flower-strewn landscape, un terrain fleuri, But Fleury was the name of one of the local noble families. Terrain Fleury, flower-covered landscape, or Fleury domain. And in the foreground of the Fleury domain is a purse, so full it has burst open. To the right of the little hill on which Christ stands is a castle ruin. To the left, a hilltop village. From down in the valley below Rennes, one can see the village, then on the skyline, a pointed hill, part of the Fleury estate, then the Chateau of Custosa. Does the purse indicate a significant point on this hillside? Here at the altar, scene of Saunier's original discovery, is a painting to which he evidently attached considerable importance. Although everything in the church was made to his detailed instructions, this painting Saunier did himself. Again, we're in a cave, or grotto. Did the one that Saunier built once resemble this? Through the cave mouth, we can see a landscape, another hill, a castle ruin. That hill, its silhouette is unmistakable. The dominant feature in the countryside at Rennes is the hill of Cardou, the eagle's nest. And the castle, again Custosa in the valley below the village. Is Saunier showing us the view from a real cave mouth somewhere in the area? Real cave mouth somewhere in the area? And is the cave mouth the spot indicated by the bag of gold on the Terrain Fleury? All these are speculations. But not all Saunier's hints are possibly meaningless reproductions of local vistas. Some are much more subtle. The devil again. The pose, the whole set of his body is strange, as if he's sitting. But where is his chair? In fact, it's on a hillside south of the village. To the locals, this stone is known as le fauteuil du diable, the devil's armchair. His hand, this odd, precise gesture, the thumb and forefinger forming a circle. Beside the devil's armchair is a spring. Its name, la source du cercle, the spring of the circle. Saunier is indicating a precise place. The church is a mass of details. The stations of the cross present many unexpected features. What is the significance of this man's gesture, and what is he holding? Why does Pilate wear a veil? Pilate washes his hands in a white dish, un plateau blanc, held by a negro. Close to Rennes, Blanchefort, the white castle, sits on its plateau beside Rocco Negro, the black rock. Why is the most prominent foreground feature in this station the seeming irrelevance of a young man picking up a stick? Why does this soldier hold his shield up in such an extraordinary pose? But it's too easy to bury ourselves in a mass of confused and confusing imagery. In fact, it's quite simple to show how very precise Saunier was in his indications, once we can understand his language. Station 6. Veronica wipes the face of Jesus. We must examine the separate components of this picture and define them in precise, though simple terms. First, the soldier holds his shield on high. We can define this element simply as high shield, haut bouclier. The shield partially obscures a tower. We can see half of it. Half tower, demi-tour. Simon of Cyrene is watching. Simon regarde. Veronica with the cloth. Veronica au lin. These will suffice to show the precision of Saunier's cryptic language. In this station, he's playing with words. High shield, au bouclier. But we're also saying, au bouclier. Demi-tour, half a tower, also means a half turn. Simon Regarde also says, Sim on regarde. Veronica Olin also says, Ver o ni kaolin. What is the message? Au bouclier, at the end of the enclosure, demi-tour, make a half turn, Ver o ni, towards the high nest. Is this Cardou, the eagle's nest? Yes, Cardou is a china clay hill. Kaolin, kaolin. Cime on regarde, the crest one is looking at. So, station 6 tells us to go to the bottom of the enclosure, make a half turn towards Cardou, and the crest we can then see, crowned with the ruins of the Chateau of Blanchefort, that is the relevant thing. Where do we go from there? Well, there are 14 stations. Much ingenuity, and perhaps some luck, someone may follow Saunière's trail to its end. But even so, will there now be anything left to find? It seems likely. Only 2 days before suffering a fatal stroke in 1917, Saunière had signed the contract for new major building works, a project to the tune of 8 million francs. There's no reason to doubt that he would have been able to foot the bill. Naturally, the will of so wealthy a man was read with interest. But even from beyond the grave, Saunière could continue his game of secrecy. His will showed that he owned nothing. Everything, his houses, his land, all his goods and chattels, proved to have been in the name of his housekeeper, Marie, his faithful servant since the days of his poverty. But did she also possess the secret? Again, it seems likely. She lived in comfort for the remainder of her long life, dying as recently as 1953, when she was laid to rest at Saunière's side. She had promised to pass on a secret before she died, but a cerebral hemorrhage left her paralyzed and speechless at the end. Her secret, whatever it was, died with her. There have been many attempts to discover the source of Saunière's wealth, to unravel the secret of Ireda. People have dug in and around the church and village, officially and unofficially. Saunière knew that the hunt would begin after his death. On his deathbed, he felt compelled to impart some terrible confidence in his final confession. What could it have been? But has anyone else followed Saunière's path to the crock of gold? There's one great handicap for those who would make the attempt. Of the four parchments which gave Saunière the key, only two remain. Even so, this parchment can open for us one more door. There's an extremely complicated cipher concealed in the interpolated letters. In part, it tells us that Poussin holds the key. Poussin. When Saunière was given the decipherments in Paris, he bought a copy of Poussin's picture, Les Bergers d'Arcadie, The Arcadian Shepherds. Painted in Rome, round about 1640, it has so far been held by art historians to be the pure product of Poussin's imagination. The shepherds are studying an inscription on the tomb, Et in Arcadia ego, even in Arcady, I, death, am present. In some way, this must throw a light on Saunière's story. Saunière, as we know, concerned himself with tomb inscriptions. He obliterated the words on certain stones in his churchyard. In particular, this stone, which lay on the tomb of the Countess of Blanchefort. But a copy of this inscription, as we also know, still exists. And here, obvious and yet disguised, is our link with the Poussin painting. Apparently part Latin, part Greek. The two lines seem meaningless. They make sense, though, when we realize that this is a Latin phrase, but written in a form of the Greek alphabet. If we transliterate, et in Arcadia ego. Even so, why should Saunière bother to obliterate it? What else can it tell us? First, these words. They can be interpreted to mean at royal redis in the caves of the fortress. Redis was one of the alternate names of Ireda, Rennes-le-Château. Now, this. Notice how the curved line begins in front of the P and ends in front of the S. Next, pri cum, as one word, meaningless. But pri means before, cum with. We've already noticed that the curved line begins before, that is, pri, the P. Let us take the letter that precedes P in the alphabet, O. Similarly, as indicated by the curve, let us take the letter preceding S, that is, R. O-R, or, the French word for gold. Having taken the letters that came before, pri, we must put them cum, that is, together with something. All that remains is this spider. The French word for spider is araignée, or araignée. Saunière has already shown us how to play with the sounds of words. Or araigne says, or araigne, the gold at Rennes. Thus the stone is saying, the gold is at Rennes, at royal redis in the caves of the fortress. But there is still et in Arcadia ego. Can this in any way add to the message? Art historians insist that Poussin never came to this part of France. But are they right? The resemblance is striking. The only addition seems to be a narrow ledge which has been built along the front. But incorporated in the ledge is this round stone, in precisely the correct spot. And close behind the tomb, a tree still grows. There would seem little doubt that this strange structure is indeed the tomb in the Poussin painting. Even his imaginary landscape is there, though subtly recomposed to suit the painter's eye. The rock. The rock. The remains of the Chateau of Blanchefort, also there in the painting. Most interestingly, from our point of view, is this little hill off in the distance. It is the hill of Rennes-le-Château, accurately placed in the painting. The village is indeed visible from the tomb. And between the two, the ruins of the Chateau of Blanchefort. And it was the tombstone of the Countess of Blanchefort which led us here. There is yet one other fascinating link between the gravestone and the tomb. The phrase, et in Arcadia ego. It is broken after et in arc. Arc. Remember the whole deciphered message. The gold is at Rennes, at royal redis, in the caves of the fortress. Now, if we continue, et in arc. And in arc. Close by the tomb of the Arcadian shepherds is a chateau. Its name? Ardea ego still remains a mystery, though of course there are theories. The hunt for Suniel's gold is still very much alive. All the answers have not yet been found. While this film was being shot, an attempt was made to break into this tomb. And someone shattered the Countess of Blanchefort's gravestone. There are still those who would give much to discover the source of Soniel's wealth, to decipher the clues. Unravel the secret of Ireda. Someone may succeed, but the trail is a difficult one. Fictional treasure hunts follow a logical progression to their final solution. This trail is not fictional. It is all too real. And nothing is as simple as it seems. Consider again this parchment. Would you imagine that this document, apart from its schoolboy code, also conceals, in fact, is built up on a complex geometrical design? It is based on this and a few crosses. What does it mean? The answer to that question, and to many more, lies lost and sleeping on that mountaintop. Henry Lincoln is a writer who for the last 2 years has been trying to find that answer.
One of the most interesting, perhaps one of the most productive ways to find a path through this morass of conflicting and confusing evidence is to try to find some sort of understanding of the character of Béranger Saunière. I've been told that he was a vulgar crook. I've also been told that the only mystery surrounding his treasure is the names of the three or four wealthy people who were giving the money to him. But that, to me, makes even a greater mystery than the one we're engaged on. Why should three or four wealthy people give him money? One of the most, perhaps, interesting hypotheses which has been put forward is that the parchments that he found were in fact genealogies relating to one of the European royal houses, and that he sold these parchments, the genealogies, to the royal house in return for an annuity. Now, if Saunière were just a vulgar crook, and all that he wanted was the money, then once he'd got his annuity, why didn't he go to Paris and enjoy the flesh pots? Why did he stay in this little tiny village, only a few miles from the place where he was born? Over the centuries, there have been persistent legends of the lost gold or a treasure in this area. For instance, during the Middle Ages, the religious military order of the Knights Templars brought in gold miners into the area, or so it was said. They were kept totally segregated from the rest of the population. And yet it seems likely that these gold miners were in fact gold workers, reconverting the golden artifacts back into crude gold, which they could bring out of the gold mine. But what about Poussin? I'm totally convinced that this painting represents the tomb and landscape of Arc near to Rennes-le-Château. But Poussin's life is very well documented, and there seems to be no evidence that he ever came to this part of France. No evidence, that is, apart from Les Bergers d'Arcadie. There is, however, one hypothesis which could fit the fact. There's a period in his early life when his movements are known with much less precision. It's possible that he came here at that time and did the sketches from which he later painted the picture. But why should he do this? Is there any reason to suppose that the sketches had any more significance to him than merely the depiction of an interesting piece of landscape? Is there anything to suggest that Poussin was the possessor of some sort of secret? Here is a letter addressed to Nicolas Fouquet, who was superintendent of finances in the court of Louis XIV. It's a letter from his brother, who had just paid a visit to Poussin in Rome, dated the 17th of April, 1656. This letter has never, until now, been fully understood, but in part it says this: "He and I discussed certain things, which I shall with ease be able to explain to you in detail. things which will give you, through Monsieur Poussin, advantages which even kings would have great pains to draw from him, and which, according to him, it is possible that nobody else will ever rediscover in the centuries to come. And what is more, these are things so difficult to discover that nothing now on this earth can prove a better fortune nor be its equal. Now this letter was commented on by an art historian, and he said, what marvellous enterprise was in Poussin's mind? What secret could he have had that kings would have pains to draw from him? It has been suggested that it could have been an important archaeological find somewhere in or near Rome. But why should we consider that the discovery was made in or near Rome? Could it not equally well have been in or near Rennes-le-Château? What was this discovery to which Poussin attached so much importance? Could it be that he discovered the whereabouts of the treasure of the Temple of Jerusalem? Well, I'm perfectly well aware that there are lots of theories as to the whereabouts of the temple treasure. It's been suggested that it's at the bottom of a river in southern Italy, that it's in Carthage, that it's in Byzantium, or that it's somewhere at the bottom of the Mediterranean Sea. It's interesting that Hitler seemed to agree that it came into this part of the world. During the war, the Germans occupied Carcassonne and the inhabitants of the old city were evacuated, and the Germans dug there. They didn't find anything, but then I think at Carcassonne they were 20 miles off course. Throughout this whole investigation, I've been trying to find the motives behind the people who have hidden away the way through to this treasure. Could it just have been a simple hoard of gold? Mustn't it be something more important as a discovery, something like the temple treasure? It was a disturbing discovery in some ways. Sonia, in fact, felt compelled to pass it on, as did everybody who has left indications to the story. It's rather like the legend of King Midas, whose touch turned everything to gold. When the barber discovered that the king had ass's ears, he felt compelled to pass on the secret, and so he dug a hole in the ground and whispered it there. Sonia felt the same compulsion, and so he left us his curious church. But that wasn't enough. Something still burdened Sonia's conscience. On his deathbed, he made a confession. The priest who heard it was deeply disturbed. It's said by those who knew him that when he left Sonia's deathbed, he was white and shaken, and for 6 months thereafter, he didn't smile at all. What terrible confidence had he received? Surely not just that Sonia had cashed in on a lucky find of gold. No, there is something extraordinary waiting to be found here. And in the not too distant future, it will be.
Collecting stones, he said, when anyone asked. And indeed, he did bring back stones, with which he built a grotto. This is all that remains of it today. What was he up to? In part, the answer lies in the church, which was totally restored and redecorated at Sonia's own expense. A labor of love, perhaps. After all, it was here that he'd found his precious parchments. The bizarre significance of all this will be examined later. Naturally, his superiors demanded an explanation of his sudden wealth, but But they met with a cool response. Secrets of the confessional, gifts from wealthy people, who, I may not say. Sauniel's lips were sealed and remained so. And for the rest of his life, 25 years, he lived luxuriously, the possessor of a seemingly bottomless purse. What treasure could he possibly have found in this remote and isolated spot? The pillar gives us the first hint. Saunier has carved on it the date of his discovery, 1891, but it dates, in fact, from the dark years of the Visigoths, one of the Germanic tribes who in the 5th and 6th centuries swept across Western Europe. This tiny village is all that remains of a mighty city. Spread there below us in the valley was once Aireda, fortified citadel, powerful, boasting 30,000 inhabitants. Aireda, one of the great strongholds of the Visigothic kingdom. But before the Visigoths, the Romans were here, mining the hillsides for gold. The Visigoths and the Romans had crossed paths elsewhere than here. That crossing of paths provides one of the most dramatic clues to our mystery. In 410 AD, the Visigoths sacked Rome. The historian Procopius describes their booty and one part in particular.
The treasures of Solomon, the king of the Hebrews, a sight most worthy to be seen. For they were adorned in the most part with emeralds, and in the olden time they had been taken from Jerusalem by the Romans.
By the Emperor Titus, in fact, in 70 AD. Carried home in triumph and depicted here on Titus's arch in Rome. And so the treasure of Solomon's temple was carried off by the Visigoths. In the 5th century, their kingdom straddled the Pyrenees. Their accumulated booty was well guarded. That part which was used to finance the running of the state was held at Toulouse, and in 507 AD was captured by Clovis, king of the Franks. But it was here at Carcassonne that the other part of their treasure was held. But it was here at Carcassonne that the other part of their treasure was held. The ancient treasure, the holy treasure, guarded as a symbol of the power, continuity, and fate of the state. The treasure of which Procopius tells us Solomon's formed part. And now, at Carcassonne, we are a mere 20 miles from Aireda, which is Rennes-le-Chateau, Saunier's village. After the capture of Toulouse, Clovis came on to besiege Carcassonne.
For he well knew that the royal treasure was there. That treasure which aforetimes Alaric the Elder had taken as booty when Rome fell to his hand.
But the Visigoths were more tenacious here. The holy treasure had to be protected. Clovis failed in his attempt. Part of this ancient treasure was eventually taken from Carcassonne to the Spanish capital of the Visigoths, Toledo. This is some of that treasure. Hidden for security when the Arabs attacked Toledo in 711, this precious hoard was discovered in the 19th century at Guarazar. But no account of booty taken by Arabs or Franks mentions Solomon's treasure. Where did it go from Carcassonne? Under the assaults of Arab and Frank, the Visigothic kingdom was eventually reduced to the Rases, of which Aireda was a principal city, one of the few strongholds of their fading power. Could it also have been the repository of their wealth, the final resting place of the holy treasure? The next link in our chain is a curious legend concerning Aireda. The year 679, when Dagobert II, Saint Dagobert, king of the Merovingian dynasty, was assassinated. Some authorities would have his infant son murdered with him, but the legend would have us believe that this child, Sigebert, was carried to Aireda and took the title Count of Rases. Here he founded a family. And it was in the little church of Rennes-le-Château that he was eventually buried before the altar. And so what seems today to be a sleepy hamlet lost to the world does indeed have a colourful and dramatic history. Perhaps there could, after all, be something hidden away here over the centuries. Something which Saunière's lucky find could lead him to. And here is a tangible link with his past of history and legend. It was this stone that Saunière uncovered when, on his return from Paris, he chose to dig at a particular spot before the altar of his church. Much worn and damaged, this could be a mounted knight riding off with a child on his saddle bow. It could depict the rescue of St. Dagobert's infant son, Sigebert. Under the stone were also discovered two skeletons. Here is one of the skulls. The ritual incision after death is not uncommon in Merovingian burials. And here, in this reliquary, is a holy relic said to be the skull of St. Dagobert. On a hillside near the village was a standing stone, the top of which was shaped into a human head. This head, now removed from its pillar, is known as the head of Dagobert, and this too has the same mark. Had Saunière's mysterious parchments thrown some light on the legend of Dagobert? An examination of them immediately raises several points. In this one, the text is clear, but it's rather oddly arranged on the page. In this one, there are the interpolated letters. Jesus, ergo, interpolated V, ante, interpolated C. What else can it tell us? First, these words. They can be interpreted to mean at royal redis in the caves of the fortress. Redis was one of the alternate names of Ireda, Rennes-le-Château. Now, this. Notice how the curved line begins in front of the P and ends in front of the S. Next, pri cum, as one word, meaningless. But pri means before, cum with. We've already noticed that the curved line begins before, that is, pri, the P. Let us take the letter that precedes P in the alphabet, O. Similarly, as indicated by the curve, let us take the letter preceding S, that is, R. O-R, or, the French word for gold. Having taken the letters that came before, pri, we must put them cum, that is, together with something. All that remains is this spider. The French word for spider is araignée, or araignée. Saunière has already shown us how to play with the sounds of words. Or araigne says or araigne, the gold at Rennes. Thus the stone is saying, the gold is at Rennes, at royal redis in the caves of the fortress. But there is still et in Arcadia ego. Can this in any way add to the message? Art historians insist that Poussin never came to this part of France. But are they right? The resemblance is striking. The only addition seems to be a narrow ledge which has been built along the front. But incorporated in the ledge is this round stone, in precisely the correct spot. And close behind the tomb, a tree still grows. There would seem little doubt that this strange structure is indeed the tomb in the Poussin painting. Even his imaginary landscape is there, though subtly recomposed to suit the painter's eye. The rock. The rock. The remains of the Chateau of Blanchefort, also there in the painting. Most interestingly, from our point of view, is this little hill off in the distance. It is the hill of Rennes-le-Chateau, accurately placed in the painting. The village is indeed visible from the tomb. And between the two, the ruins of the Chateau of Blanchefort. And it was the tombstone of the Countess of Blanchefort which led us here. There is yet one other fascinating link between the gravestone and the tomb. The phrase, et in Arcadia ego. It is broken after et in arc. Arc. Remember the whole deciphered message. The gold is at Rennes, at royal redis, in the caves of the fortress. Now, if we continue, et in arc, and in arc. Close by the tomb of the Arcadian shepherds is a chateau. Its name? Ardea ego still remains a mystery, though of course there are theories. The hunt for Suniel's gold is still very much alive. All the answers have not yet been found. While this film was being shot, an attempt was made to break into this tomb. And someone shattered the Countess of Blanchefort's gravestone. There are still those who would give much to discover the source of Suniel's wealth, to decipher the clues. Many have tried to unravel the secret of Irena. Someone may succeed. But the trail is a difficult one. Fictional treasure hunts follow a logical progression to their final solution. This trail is not fictional. It is all too real. And nothing is as simple as it seems. Consider again this parchment. Would you imagine that this document, apart from its schoolboy code, also conceals, in fact is built up on, a complex geometrical design? It is based on this and a few crosses. What does it mean? The answer to that question, and to many more, lies lost and sleeping on that mountaintop. Henry Lincoln is a writer who for the last 2 years has been trying to find that answer.
One of the most interesting, perhaps one of the most productive ways to find a path through this morass of conflicting and confusing evidence is to try to find some sort of understanding of the character of Bérenger Saunière. I've been told that he was a vulgar crook. I've also been told that the only mystery surrounding his treasure is the names of the three or four wealthy people who were giving the money to them. But that, to me, makes even a greater mystery than the one we're engaged on. Why should three or four wealthy people give him money? One of the most, perhaps, interesting hypotheses which has been put forward is that the parchments that he found were, in fact, genealogies relating to one of the European royal houses, and that he sold these parchments, the genealogies, to the royal house in return for an annuity. Now, if Saunière were just a vulgar crook, and all that he wanted was the money, then once he got his annuity, why didn't he go to Paris and enjoy the flesh pots? Why did he stay in this little tiny village, only a few miles from the place where he was born? Over the centuries, there have been persistent
DA's interpolated P, etc. But even more apparent than these is this odd device. The general impression of the document is one of neatness. The apparent untidiness here cannot be fortuitous. Superficially, we could be looking at a direction indicator. N denotes north, indicated by the untidy arrow. But the N-O-I-S seems meaningless. At the other end of the device, we have a more clear arrowhead. But isn't this arrowhead, in fact, an A upside down? And now the NOIS is perhaps no longer meaningless. Zion, Zion, Jerusalem. And we've already followed to Rennes-le-Château the possible trail of the holy treasure of the Visigoths, which may have contained relics of the sacking of Jerusalem. Now the other parchment. Why are the words at the ends of lines broken in seemingly arbitrary fashion? But here again is our key word, Zion, Jerusalem. What else? One other immediately noticeable feature is this isolated A, the only letter isolated in the text. The letter A, remember, was significant in the other parchment. And a closer examination reveals that this A is raised above the line of the other letters. Are there more raised letters? What message is being spelt out? À Dagobert de Rouen et à Zion et ce trésor et il est la mort. This treasure belongs to Dagobert II, king, and to Zion, and the last phrase is open to two different readings. Il est la mort, it is death, or il est là, mort, he is there, dead. Who, Dagobert? Were the two bodies found before the altar, those of St. Dagobert and his son Sigebert? There is, of course, more to these parchments than just this simple, one might almost say childish code. But being easy to find, the code, in effect, says to us, you're on the right lines, now look further. Saunière evidently did, and found his crock of gold. Whatever it was that he found, he was certainly jealous of the secret, but by no means selfish in his distribution of the benefits. He entertained lavishly. He made many charitable gifts. Local families received open-handed help. He built this water tower to give his parishioners piped water to their homes. He had the rough 4-kilometer-long dirt track made over into a good modern road. And he gave away not only money. To a fellow priest, he presented an ancient and beautiful chalice. To another, a collection of ancient coins like these, some of them dating from the time of Dagobert. And, of course, there was his lavish expenditure on the little village church. But this was not a simple act of generosity. It was Saunière's contribution to the pattern of mystery surrounding his treasure. Externally, there seems to be nothing exceptional here. But overhead, as we approach the door, terribilis est locus iste. This place is terrible. Terrible indeed, for once through the door. Not just a devil, but Asmodeus. And Asmodeus was the legendary guardian of Solomon's treasure. All around us is a strange phantasmagoric world of imagery and color. The more one looks, the stranger it becomes. Like his predecessors, with their cryptic parchments and tomb inscriptions, Saunière felt compelled to pass on his secret in some way. But in typically flamboyant fashion, Saunière's cipher was on a grand scale. His clue to the treasure was to be the church itself. Certainly, Saunière's bishop was disturbed when he came to bless the restored edifice. Thereafter, it seems, he paid the church no further pastoral visits. But what is Saunière saying to us in this mass of imagery? A few of the features will give an insight into his methods. For example, here Christ succors the afflicted. He stands on a flower-strewn landscape, un terrain fleuri. But Fleury was the name of one of the local noble families. Terrain Fleury, flower-covered landscape, or Fleury domain. And in the foreground of the Fleury domain is a purse, so full it has burst open. To the right of the little hill on which Christ stands is a castle ruin. To the left, the hilltop village. From down in the valley below Rennes, one can see the village, then on the skyline a pointed hill, part of the Fleury estate, then the Chateau of Custosa. Does the purse indicate a significant point on this hillside? Here at the altar, scene of Saunier's original discovery, is a painting to which he evidently attached considerable importance. Although everything in the church was made to his detailed instructions, this painting Saunier did himself. Again, we're in a cave, or grotto. Did the one that Saunier built once resemble this? Through the cave mouth, we can see a landscape. Another hill, a castle ruin. That hill, its silhouette is unmistakable. The dominant feature in the countryside at Rennes is the hill of Cardou, the eagle's nest. And the castle, again Custosa in the valley below the village. Is Saunier showing us the view from a real cave mouth somewhere in the area? And is the cave mouth the spot indicated by the bag of gold on the terrain fleuri? All these are speculations. But not all Saunier's hints are possibly meaningless reproductions of local vistas. Some are much more subtle. The devil again. The pose, the whole set of his body is strange, as if he's sitting. But where is his chair? In fact, it's on a hillside south of the village. To the locals, this stone is known as le fauteuil du diable, the devil's armchair. His hand, this odd, precise gesture, the thumb and forefinger forming a circle. A remote corner of southwestern France. Perched high on its hilltop, an isolated village, tiny. Rennes-le-Chateau, a village forbidden to the archaeologist. Fouille interdite, excavation forbidden. Why? What could there be hidden in so insignificant a place that would be worth digging for? And what has he to do with it? What secret does this parchment conceal? What connects this gravestone with this painting by Poussin? And what link is there between St. Dagobert, the Emperor Titus, and this French priest? What great treasure did he find here 80 years ago? Rennes-le-Château. There is little to suggest to the casual visitor the drama of its hidden story. A little church, a crumbling chateau, a few houses. And 60 inhabitants. To this dot on the map, in the late 1880s, was sent a young priest, Béranger Saunier, a virile, handsome, ambitious man, to whom this village must have seemed a place of exile, a dead end. His first years here were a time of poverty and hardship. His accounts show over 16 months, expenses 90 francs, £3.60, income only 25 francs. Unable to afford even a modest lodging, his home was a crumbling shack, even more dilapidated than his little church. The state of the church fabric, caused Saunier much concern. This building, which should have been the centerpiece of his life and of the lives of his flock, was growing daily more ruinous. In desperation, Saunier begged a small sum from the mayor to carry out the most urgent repairs. With no idea how the debt would ever be repaid, he set to work. The altar stone was damaged. He had it lifted from its supporting pillars. One of the pillars, this one, was hollow. Inside, parchments, passages from the Gospels in Latin. The first link in a chain of discovery which led to wealth and luxury for this poor parish priest, and endless speculation and investigation for those who have since then stumbled onto the mystery. They're curious documents, the one oddly arranged on the page, the other dotted with scores of interpolated letters. Saunier soon realized that they contained ciphers. He needed the advice of experts. Borrowing the cost of the fare, he traveled to Paris and went immediately to see the director of the seminary of the Church of Saint-Sulpice, whose nephew he knew had the necessary skill. During the week or so that it took the paleographer to study the documents, Saunier made the most of his unexpected holiday. In some extraordinary way, he was able to make the acquaintance of the glamorous and world-famous opera singer, Emma Calvé. His cloth was evidently no bar to a ripening friendship, which was to continue spasmodically over the years to come. However, his liaison with Calvé was not the only curiosity to stem from this trip to Paris. At last, at Saint-Sulpice, the expert was ready with his findings. And all unknowing, he put into the priest's hand the key to an incredible fortune. Saunier now undertook a strange errand. He paid a visit to the Louvre, and there he chose to buy a copy of this painting by Nicolas Poussin. He then returned immediately to Rennes-le-Château and to a totally new life. Within a short space of time, he was spending money at an extraordinary rate. He bought land. He laid out this garden. On one side, he built a handsome house, the Villa Bethany. On the other side, this dramatic tower, the Tour Magdala. No expense was spared. No expense seemed too much. Why did Saunier's expert not realize the value of the secret the priest had found in his little church? The answer would seem to be quite simple. In Saunier's country, the streams, the very rocks, bear strange names. And what significance would a stranger find in a reference to the circle, the dead man, or the eagle's nest? But Saunier knew, and from his tower he could keep watch over the countryside, which, no longer a dead end, was now so precious to him. His newfound wealth depended on a secret, and Saunier took pains to protect it. Some of the gravestones in his churchyard were evidently connected with the mystery. He obliterated the inscriptions, moved stones. Under this arch is one of them, featureless now. But by a lucky chance, the wording had already been copied by a collector of tomb inscriptions. This is what Saunier took such pains to wipe out. This stone lay on the grave of Marie de Négry d'Ablès, Countess of Blanchefort. And this is the headstone of that same grave. It's a curious inscription, prepared in 1781 by the Blanchefort family chaplain, Antoine Bigou, the reputed author of Saunier's parchments. And like one of the parchments, it's curiously arranged. For example, the initial M of Marie has been separated. Requiescat has been split in two. This stone held part of the secret, and Saunier made sure that the stone should no longer speak. In many ways, his behavior became odd. He spent days wandering the hillside. Beside the devil's armchair is a spring. Its name, La Source du Cercle, the spring of the circle. Saunière is indicating a precise place. The church is a mass of details. The stations of the cross present many unexpected features. What is the significance of this man's gesture, and what is he holding? Why does Pilate wear a veil? Pilate washes his hands in a white dish, un plateau blanc, held by a negro. Close to Rennes, Blanchefort, the white castle, sits on its plateau beside Rocco Negro, the black rock. Why is the most prominent foreground feature in this station the seeming irrelevance of a young man picking up a stick? Why does this soldier hold his shield up in such an extraordinary pose? But it's too easy to bury ourselves in a mass of confused and confusing imagery. In fact, it's quite simple to show how very precise Saunière was in his indications, once we can understand his language. Station 6. Veronica wipes the face of Jesus. We must examine the separate components of this picture and define them in precise, though simple, terms. First, the soldier holds his shield on high. We can define this element simply as high shield, haut bouclier. The shield partially obscures a tower. We can see half of it. Half tower, demi-tour. Simon of Cyrene is watching. Simon regarde. Veronica with the cloth. Veronica au lin. These will suffice to show the precision of Saunière's cryptic language. In this station, he's playing with words. High shield, au bouclier. But we're also saying au bouclier. Demi-tour, half a tower, also means a half turn. Simon regarde also says sim en regarde. Veronica au lin also says ver au ni kaolin. What is the message? Au bouclier, at the end of the enclosure. Demi-tour, make a half turn. Vers au nid, towards the high nest. Is this Cardou, the eagle's nest? Yes, Cardou is a china clay hill. Kaolin, kaola. Cime on regarde, the crest one is looking at. So, station 6 tells us to go to the bottom of the enclosure, make a half turn towards Cardou, and the crest we can then see, crowned with the ruins of the Chateau of Blanchefort, that is the relevant thing. Where do we go from there? Well, there are 14 stations. Much ingenuity, and perhaps some luck, someone may follow Saunière's trail to its end. But even so, will there now be anything left to find? It seems likely. Only 2 days before suffering a fatal stroke in 1917, Saunière had signed the contract for new major building works, a project to the tune of 8 million francs. There's no reason to doubt that he would have been able to foot the bill. Naturally, the will of so wealthy a man was read with interest. But even from beyond the grave, Saunière could continue his game of secrecy. His will showed that he owned nothing. Everything, his houses, his land, all his goods and chattels, proved to have been in the name of his housekeeper, Marie, his faithful servant since the days of his poverty. But did she also possess the secret? Again, it seems likely. She lived in comfort for the remainder of her long life, dying as recently as 1953, when she was laid to rest at Saunière's side. She had promised to pass on a secret before she died. But a cerebral hemorrhage left her paralyzed and speechless at the end. Her secret, whatever it was, died with her. There have been many attempts to discover the source of Soniel's wealth, to unravel the secret of Irena. People have dug in and around the church and village, officially and unofficially. Soniel knew that the hunt would begin after his death. On his deathbed, he felt compelled to impart some terrible confidence in his final confession. What could it have been? But has anyone else followed Soniel's path to the crock of gold? There's one great handicap for those who would make the attempt. Of the four parchments which gave Soniel the key, only two remain. Even so, this parchment can open for us one more door. There's an extremely complicated cipher concealed in the interpolated letters. In part, it tells us that Poussin holds the key. Poussin. When Soniel was given the decipherments in Paris, he bought a copy of Poussin's picture, Les Bergers d'Arcadie, The Arcadian Shepherds. Painted in Rome, round about 1640, it has so far been held by art historians to be the pure product of Poussin's imagination. The shepherds are studying an inscription on the tomb, Et in Arcadia ego, even in Arcady, I, death, am present. In some way, this must throw a light on Soniel's story. Soniel, as we know, concerned himself with tomb inscriptions. He obliterated the words on certain stones in his churchyard. In particular, this stone, which lay on the tomb of the Countess of Blanchefort. But a copy of this inscription, as we also know, still exists. And here, obvious and yet disguised, is our link with the Poussin painting. Apparently part Latin, part Greek. The two lines seem meaningless. They make sense, though, when we realize that this is a Latin phrase, but written in a form of the Greek alphabet. If we transliterate, et in Arcadia ego. Even so, why should Soniel bother to obliterate it? A remote corner of southwestern France. Perched high on its hilltop, an isolated village, tiny. Rennes-le-Chateau, a village forbidden to the archaeologist. Fouille interdite, excavation forbidden. Why? What could there be hidden in so insignificant a place that would be worth digging for? And what has he to do with it? What secret does this parchment conceal? What connects this gravestone with this painting by Poussin? And what link is there between Saint Dagobert, the Emperor Titus, and this French priest? What great treasure did he find here 80 years ago? Rennes-le-Château. There is little to suggest to the casual visitor the drama of its hidden story. A little church, a crumbling chateau, a few houses. And 60 inhabited luxuriously, the possessor of a seemingly bottomless purse. What treasure could he possibly have found in this remote and isolated spot? The pillar gives us the first hint. Saunier has carved on it the date of his discovery, 1891, but it dates, in fact, from the dark years of the Visigoths, one of the Germanic tribes who in the 5th and 6th centuries swept across Western Europe. This tiny village is all that remains of a mighty city. Spread there below us in the valley was once Ireda, fortified citadel, powerful, boasting 30,000 inhabitants. Ireda, one of the great strongholds of the Visigothic kingdom. But before the Visigoths, the Romans were here, mining the hillsides for gold. The Visigoths and the Romans had crossed paths elsewhere than here. That crossing of paths provides one of the most dramatic clues to our mystery. In 410 AD, the Visigoths sacked Rome. The historian Procopius describes their booty, and one part in particular.
The treasures of Solomon, the king of the Hebrews, a sight most worthy to be seen. For they were adorned in the most part with emeralds, and in the olden time they had been taken from Jerusalem by the Romans.
By the Emperor Titus, in fact, in 70 AD. Carried home in triumph and depicted here on Titus's arch in Rome. And so the treasure of Solomon's temple was carried off by the Visigoths. In the 5th century, their kingdom straddled the Pyrenees. Their accumulated booty. To this dot on the map, in the late 1880s, was sent a young priest, Béranger Saunier, a virile, handsome, ambitious man, to whom this village must have seemed a place of exile, a dead end. His first years here were a time of poverty and hardship. His accounts show over 16 months, expenses 90 francs, £3.60, income only 25 francs. Unable to afford even a modest lodging, his home was a crumbling shack, even more dilapidated than his little church. The state of the church fabric caused Saunier much concern. This building, which should have been the centerpiece of his life and of the lives of his flock, was growing daily more ruinous. In desperation, Saunier begged a small sum from the mayor to carry out the most urgent repairs. With no idea how the debt would ever be repaid, he set to work. The altar stone was damaged. He had it lifted from its supporting pillars. One of the pillars, this one, was hollow. Inside, parchments, passages from the Gospels in Latin. The first link in a chain of discovery which led to wealth and luxury for this poor parish priest, and endless speculation and investigation for those who have since then stumbled onto the mystery. They're curious documents, the one oddly arranged on the page, the other dotted with scores of interpolated letters. Saunier soon realized that they contained ciphers. He needed the advice of experts. Borrowing the cost of the fare, he traveled to Paris and went immediately to see the director of the seminary of the Church of Saint-Sulpice, whose nephew he knew had the necessary skill. During the week or so that it took the paleographer to study the documents, Saunier made the most of his unexpected holiday. In some extraordinary way, he was able to make the acquaintance of the glamorous and world-famous opera singer, Emma Calvey. His cloth was evidently no bar to a ripening friendship, which was to continue spasmodically over the years to come. However, his liaison with Calvey was not the only curiosity to stem from this trip to Paris. At last, at Saint-Sulpice, the expert was ready with his findings. And all unknowing, he put into the priest's hand the key to an incredible fortune. Saunier now undertook a strange errand. He paid a visit to the Louvre, and there he chose to buy a copy of this painting by Nicolas Poussin. He then returned immediately to Rennes-le-Château and to a totally new life. Within a short space of time, he was spending money at an extraordinary rate. He bought land. He laid out this garden. On one side, he built a handsome house, the Villa Bethany. On the other side, this dramatic tower, the Tour Magdala. No expense was spared. No expense seemed too much. Why did Sonia's expert not realize the value of the secret the priest had found in his little church? The answer would seem to be quite simple. In Sonia's country, the streams, the very rocks, bear strange names. And what significance would a stranger find in a reference to the circle, the dead man, or the eagle's nest? But Sonia knew. And from his tower, he could keep watch over the countryside, which, no longer a dead end, was now so precious to him. His newfound wealth depended on a secret, and Saunière took pains to protect it. Some of the gravestones in his churchyard were evidently connected with the mystery. He obliterated the inscriptions, moved the stone. Under this arch is one of them, featureless now. But by a lucky chance, the wording had already been copied by a collector of tomb inscriptions. This is what Saunière took such pains to wipe out. This stone lay on the grave of Marie de Négry d'Ablès, Countess of Blanchefort. And this is the headstone of that same grave. It's a curious inscription, prepared in 1781 by the Blanchefort family chaplain, Antoine Bigot, the reputed author of Saunière's parchments. And like one of the parchments, it's curiously arranged. For example, the initial M of Marie has been separated. Requiescat has been split in two. This stone held part of the secret. And Saunière made sure that the stone should no longer speak. In many ways, his behavior became odd. He spent days wandering the hillsides, collecting stones, he said, when anyone asked. And indeed, he did bring back stones, with which he built a grotto. This is all that remains of it today. What was he up to? In part, the answer lies in the church, which was totally restored and redecorated at Saunière's own expense. A labor of love, perhaps. After all, it was here that he'd found his precious parchments. The bizarre significance of all this will be examined later. Naturally, his superiors demanded an explanation of his sudden wealth, but they met with a cool response. Secrets of the confessional, gifts from wealthy people. Who, I may not say. Saunière's lips were sealed and remained so. And for the rest of his life, 25 years, he lived